Hey folks, Landstryder here, and you're watching episode 12 in my playthrough of Horizons. This pack's available on the Feed the Beast launcher. So you might notice that I'm not wearing any armor right now. That is because I kind of gave up on the modular armor. It's going to require that I make a ridiculous amount of upgrades to each individual piece in order for it to actually give me any protection. So I have to give it protection from spiders and protection from undead and protection, etc., 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 in order to get it to work. And I wasn't too impressed with its ability to protect me. So I'm going to go with something a little more familiar. I was trying to do something new, but it didn't work out. So we're going to go with clockwork armor. And that's going to get me stuff that's going to pretty much never have to be remade again. So I've gone ahead and made my mainsprings with maximum amount of attention, and what I use for that is because we don't have a ton of uses for lead. I just used up a whole lot of lead. We have like over 300 lead before I started making these mainsprings, but I used a massive amount of lead to get these up to maximum tension. And all of my clockworks are a standard brass bronze combination that gives me nice quality and a pretty good speed that should give me diamond level or better protection when I put these together. So let's go ahead and just put these together and see what we get. We need a clockwork and a spring in each piece. And then they will need to be wound up. And they should last quite a while with that much tension and a pretty good clockwork in them. So let's just combine a few things. Then we're gonna go check out. The dimension that Dornell just built. Well, the second dimension that Dornell built. I'm not gonna talk about the first dimension. It was a little bit of a disaster. Okay, now I gotta wind these all up. You wanna tell them about your first dimension while I wind these? He's ignoring.
Go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead. You tell them. It was your dimension. I didn't actually go over there, so I didn't see it. So.
Well, we already had an effect on dimension, so I just added a digit to the dimension. So we went to another effect on dimension, and it ended up being ender orb berry bushes and time sand. Everywhere, so you couldn't leave the platform where you came in, because there was nothing to walk on.
I mean, it sounds cool, but apparently it was very bad, and the flowing time sand. He ended up crashing out of it. Barely got back. So yeah, we're not going to that dimension, but he did make another new one that you said is pretty cool, huh? Let's see if our energy cell over here is charged up enough. No, not really. It's charging, but it's not charged enough.
I'm getting some pretty good dimlets over here.
The reactor should be ready to go today, so we're going to turn that on here in a little bit. I need a flight mod. I need a flight ring, though, first, before I go over there. So I'm going to go ahead and make that real quick. I think I'm just going to go with invisible, because I already have this clockwork armor. Kind of has its own, kind of wing things on the back of it, so I don't really want to combine more wings with that, so I'm just going to go with invisible, which is two pieces of glass, and we are really running low on iron. We're down to like just a few bits of iron, so we're going to have to run that really soon. So I need iron, I need diamonds to get my unstable ingots, and I'm going to need four bits of gold, glass, got it. Okay, that's everything I need. And then one more, well, I have torches, that'll work. So one other thing I like to do whenever I'm making wings is I like to fill in all of my block. Anytime I'm doing something with more than one unstable ingot, to fill in all of my spaces so that all of my unstable ingots end up right up here close to the crafting grid. Less mouse movement equals done faster equals less likelihood of being dead. from this. So I'm going to get two ingots out of there. So they're going to go right into those slots. Then I'm going to swap everything up in there real quick. And done this twice already on the server, so I shouldn't have any problem with this. And done. There we go. Angel Wings of Invisibility. Invisible Angel Wings. And I can put that in one of my ring slots so it doesn't have to take up an inventory space. And now I have Create a Flight. Yay! Create a Flight. Let's see. And if you notice down on my bar, I have maximum armor protection. So we should be good there. I think we're going to be good with the Clockwork Armor. I don't know the exact amount, but obviously it's as high as diamond or higher. I'll probably test it, let these guys poke at me a bit. Nothing. Yeah.
What's the dimlet that makes it daytime all the time?
That would be time noon dimlet is the one we're looking for.
So the sky bright day dimlet isn't.
No, that just makes it actually brighter in the daytime. I think I'm going to go ahead and just grab our power cell for now. Even though it's not fully charged, it should be plenty of charge to get enough to get some iron ore from over here in this dimension that he's in.
Got some hot planes, dimlet.
Okay.
And I guess I got to take my dug out. But I am full, so I'm going back to empty out.
Okay, I'm going to give me a little time sand for my sword before I head over there.
Now, this is what I've been doing to know I've been in the building. I'm lighting it up. Okay. So if the light's on, if the glowstone's lit up, you know that the building's been gone through.
Oh, I usually just break the antenna. Because there's like a glowstone on top of the antenna.
Yeah, you can do that. Just leave the one glowstone in the wall that shows outside. Because if it's lit up, then you know you've been in there, you know?
Okay. Well, this is cool. There's like a dungeon right on top, isn't there?
Yeah. And you took my only way to charge my porter.
Oh, sorry. Maybe we should make another one. We need to make another one anyway.
So. I'll go up to the things and stick it in the windmill.
Okay, so this is not what I was expecting. This is like a flat world. It's kind of nice. We can get, and we got dungeons right on top, so that's interesting. What kind of dungeon is this? I hear something. I hear there's a that noise you hear is from the essential craft mod. It's some kind of magic device thing, and it's probably underneath here, I'm guessing. If we break down... Oh, wait, what's that? It's an Essential Craft presence there. Something is there. MRU presence. Okay, so that's from the Essential Craft thing. Interesting. It's a very interesting world, Jen. Flat, stone, should have lots of ore down inside of it. So, yeah, these little things are the Essential Craft presence. So there's something there. I just can't see it. I don't have the thing to see it. And these are like little dungeons. Where's the loot is what I'm wondering. Oh, here it is. Loot. Oh, look at all this beautiful loot. Beautiful loot. Hey, I got some enderlily seeds. Nice. Oh, yeah, some Earl Grey tea. Hot. Tea Earl Grey. Hot. Love it. Disposable batteries, interesting. Ancient parcels, some interesting things. The nice thing is this dungeon's right on the surface, and I can just go ahead and loot it, and there's no mob spawning because it's all lit. It's all well lit. Very interesting. And if I need mob spawners, I can easily get mob spawners now. That is very awesome. All kinds of really good loot. Gain 3 times the experience from breaking blocks. An amulet that says each attack uses UBR menu. You can hit as fast as you click. Interesting. Portable matrix deconstructor. An X-ring. Gain twice as much experience from any source, but you only gain half of the UBMRU. That might be interesting. That might be one I might use occasionally. Oh, there are more chests. so many things to loot. This is actually a pretty decent dimension. Lots of amulets and rings and such. Knowledge notes, I need those. All the stuff. Oh, I can't even carry any more stuff. I got so much stuff. Some blood magic stuff. I definitely want the unknown niblets. So we're going to need a way to carry a bunch more things if we want to get back out of here. Let's head back towards the starter point. It was over here somewhere. This is general direction. I don't think I'm going to put the miner right there so we don't got to go looking for it later. It'll be right by the entry area. Because we definitely... Oh, right there. It's the entry spot. We definitely need some iron. Really bad. So, let's look in here. Put some of this stuff away, I guess. Or something away. So I can get this out. Put that down. And we're going to configure it. Reset it. Configure it for... maximum radius, minimum of 0. Maximum of 60. What are we at? 60? No, we're at Y128. So it must go deep. There's a cave underneath us. That's what it is. There's a cave under this level, I bet. There's a big giant cavern down in there. I'm thinking. So let's actually configure this to go to 128. And we're going to change this to delete that. New filter. We're going to go ore dictionary. We need iron of anything. Any kind of iron will do. Save that. And I think we're good to go. It just needs to run. No, we're run. Start. Go. There we go. 900 some blocks of iron. That should do pretty good. Just need to give it some power. So... can keep mining. And we need to rotate that. That wasn't the right kind of rotation, I don't think. I think it's on the bottom. Nope, now it's on the side. Yeah, it was on the bottom. Now it's on the top. No. There we go. Now it's facing the right direction. Send power into there. Now if I check in here, it should have full power. We're good to go. It's also getting iron bars. Interesting. So those any of those dungeons that have those iron bars, it's going to pull them up and pick them up. It's probably going to pick up some of the like these dungeons here. Oh. And since it's raining, the mobs can come out. But I think that's good for now. I'm going to let that run for a little bit, and I'll be back when I'm ready to do a little. Okay, folks, I'm back. We've gotten a whole bunch of iron and processed a bit of that up. Made some steel, made some more cables. Let me show you guys what we've been doing upstairs. We have been working on laying out our area up here. This is just kind of a rough kind of sketch. We use using some stained clay to kind of propose some walls. But this area over here is definite. This is our transporter room, and I'm trying to kind of make it look a little bit like the Star Trek transporter room. I think we've come somewhat close. I'm going to have to change a few more blocks on floor and ceiling, of course, to get that final touch. But I don't know. You guys can let me know what you think in the comments. We got a little display over there and the control panel right here. I'm not sure which one's going to go right there just yet. Probably a screen controller, because I think we need a nice RF tool screen to keep track of things in here. Something else that might go nearby is the matter overdrive stuff. I'm going to get into that pretty soon. But this little room right here is going to be where we do all of our dimension editing and building. And you notice we got a ton of dimension builders. That's the way we can keep dimensions going and powered up. And if we get one that requires a lot of power, we can actually make multiple dimension tabs for the same dimension and put them in more than one of the dimension builders so that we can actually feed even more power into it if we make one that is ridiculous, which we might eventually do because we are about to have some ridiculous power. So let's go take a look at that. Let's go take a look. Obviously, over here we got this big tank of stuff. This is our fuel. This is our DT fuel. And let's go step through the whole fuel process before we actually can kill the mobs in there. They keep spawning in there because I got darkness in there. I need to put a light in there, I think. Maybe just put a torch down in there for a minute where they don't come back.
I can do that.
Okay. But this is our tank of DT fuel. And DT stands for... what does this stand for? Deuterium... deuterium tritium. So what we're doing is up on the ceiling, up on the roof here. You remember we worked on these towers and we made all these neutron activators, and that is what all this is doing. Why is it not actually doing anything right now? It's not making anything. Doesn't look like it is anyway. So what might be going on is I think we might not have enough. One of the issues that we have is these things only work once they reach a certain temperature, and they only work in the daytime. So they get up to a temperature like about midday, and then they produce a little bit of fuel, and then the night comes along or it rains, and then they don't work at nighttime or when it's raining, which is kind of a bummer. But this one produces brine, which feeds over into this one, which turns that brine into lithium. Actually, it is doing a little bit of work right now, lithium. That lithium is then fed into this rotary condensator, which turns the liquid lithium into gaseous lithium. That is fed into all the neutron activators. And neutron activators take lithium and turn it into tritium. The tritium then feeds into, or gets pulled out of there, and is fed into this chemical infuser. Chemical infuser combines the tritium fuel with the deuterium fuel to make the DT fuel that is going to be used in the reactor. And in order to store a large amount of DT fuel, I wanted to use a dynamic tank. So we have to actually, since that's a gas, the DT fuel is a gas, we had to use another rotary condensator to turn gas into liquid, which can then be stored in this tank. I'll show you the other end here in a minute, but let's talk about real quick the deuterium. Deuterium is made from heavy water that in an electrolytic separator. You get deuterium and oxygen. Right now we're just dumping the oxygen. We don't really have any special reason to save that much oxygen, and we need a continuous flow of deuterium. So basically, deuterium in reality, deuterium is a hydrogen molecule that has a neutron instead of just a single proton. So that's what the deuterium is. That gets fed into the infuser as well on the other side for the other half of the DT fuel. So let's go down and take a look. So in order to use it in the reactor, we actually need the gas to form. So we are actually reconverting it back into gas down here with another rotary condensator that's turning liquid DT fuel back into gaseous DT fuel and feeds it into the reactor. Now we actually got some extra ports over here. I added some extra ports while Dornell was AFK so that we could eventually feed the deuterium and tritium gas directly into the reactor. Because that is a possibility. And the reactor will actually do the combination internally later on, if we want to. We don't have to, but the valves are there. I also added a couple more of the, what are they called? Are they called valves or hatches? I forget. Let me look. What's it say over here? Port. It's called port. I'm getting it totally wrong. I added two more ports on this side for energy extraction, and I'm hoping that having these ultimate energy cubes right up against them will allow for maximum energy transfer to them. We'll have to see if these guys fill up. And we got a network of energy cables here and a few lasers. Let's Let me turn this laser on for a second. Now what's going to happen there? Well, let me get a lever up there first. Because what's going to happen is, and I don't really need to add too much more energy, I hope. We have currently just over 4 million joules stored, which translates into about 400 megajoules. Translates into about 1 million RF, I think. Hopefully we got this right. If not, we'll find out really soon. So I'm going to... Actually, that's the wrong spot. I actually want that right there for now. So that's going to disconnect all of the surrounding cables. We can actually change some of these to ignore redstone. Like this one right here probably could be ignoring the redstone. So if we want to do that, we need the configurator, and we need it to be in energy mode. And no. There we go. Redstone sensitivity turned off on that one. So I just need that one to be disconnected when I don't want to be feeding the lasers. I'm going to feed the lasers in a second just so you can see and hear it, because it is kind of spectacular. So let's just switch this on for a second. And I see nothing and hear nothing. I hear it, but I'm not seeing it. Weird.
It's not hitting everything. This one didn't light up at all. So you might have to reconfigure that cable again.
Oh, okay. Maybe that was it. No. We'll just go back to normal piece of cable. Let's take that one out, put it back, replace it, and it should act normally now. There we go. We'll just do that. It doesn't matter if it doesn't physically, or if it doesn't look like it's kind of... Let's try that again. There we go.
There you go.
And you can hear that it makes a massive whoa noise. It makes a huge laser beam that feeds into this final laser amplifier. Now, the laser amplifier right here is being fed a redstone signal to prevent it from shooting this energy off. As soon as we flip that lever, it's going to burst that entire amount of energy into the reactor. And we're not ready yet, because we still need to put something in the reactor. There is an item that must be inserted into the reactor that we don't have yet.
A holoram,
which we don't have in there just yet. So we're going to have to make one of those real quick. But as you can see, it is filled with fuel, ready to go. This gives you some kind of statistics to kind of give you an idea of what you need to do and how much energy that you're probably going to produce and the minimal injection rate to keep the reaction running. So the minimum injection rate is 2, which is what we have set to. So it's going to initially produce a large amount of energy, and it's going to cool off to the minimal reacting rate and then not produce quite as much. But at first, it's going to produce a massive amount of energy and then cool down a little bit, and then produce a steady amount of energy after a while. So we need the holoram. Let's see if I can... I was looking at redstone controls. The silico mod is in, and I've never played with it before, and it has some pretty complex... Holoram? Why don't we look at mechanism? Mechanism stuff.
We'll have that in just a minute.
You already found the recipe, I assume.
Yes, I have, but we're gonna have to fill it with fuel.
There it is. Yeah, holoram. That should be not a problem, because we can just put it in the tank. Or no, does it have to be gaseous fuel?
I think so.
Yeah, it probably does have to be gaseous fuel. Okay. That's okay. So holoram is some carbon and some gold dust. 4 gold dust in our infuser. You got the holoram? Very nice. Simple. Probably even already had carbon in there and ready to go. That's easy enough. Do we have a tank? Do we have a spare tank? If we just take a spare tank.
I can make a quick tank for you.
Okay. Yeah, if we just take a spare tank and place it on this... gas pipe over here, it will be able to fill the holoram up for us. Dornell's getting that ready to go. Yep. All right. Just stick it on the bottom of this pipe anywhere. It'll fill up with the DT fuel gas. And it has an interface that we can put the holoram in. And there we go. Now we got a full holoram. Very nice. All right. You can probably pick that up. And yeah, it drained.
I'll let you do it.
Extra fuel out of there. What we can do is we can actually now replace that there. And you can see that the little red dot is to the pipe. So it will now export that gas. And that has a little bit of extra gas that'll be ready to go for the reactor in case this works. In case it works. Kind of, I'm half expecting it not to work because I'm not 100% sure we got enough power in the laser to do it. So this holoram goes into that slot. That's the only thing that you would want to put in there. Then we're going to take that down, and I think we're ready to flip the laser switch and see if we get a reaction. So when I flip this switch, it's going to burst that entire amount of energy into the reactor. And if everything goes right, it'll turn on. Poof.
Nope.
It wasn't enough energy. Okay. So we're going to need more energy than what we just tried to put in there. A lot more energy to get that reaction started. That's a bummer, but okay. So I guess we would be back in about an hour after our lasers charge up again. And we'll give it another shot. So, and we'll figure out how many megajoules it actually takes to get it started. I was thinking it was 400 megajoules, but I think the conversion rate's the other way around. I think I accidentally switched the conversion rate. Well, I know it's supposed to take, what is it, 1 million RF? Is that what we found out? We found out that it was like 1 million RF to start it.
And, yeah, I think it was 1 million, yeah. No, 100 million.
100 million, okay. Well, I thought the 400 million joules converted into 100 million RF, but I was wrong. Anyway, while we take the break, bring the server down and switch that so that we can actually see RF instead of joules? Because that would make things a lot easier for us to figure out.
I'm good with that.
All right. We'll be back in a little bit. We're going to bring the server down and change a quick setting in the config. So if you go into your mechanism configuration and change the energy type from J to RF, pretty much all your machines should display RF instead of joules. And that might make things easier for you if you're more familiar with the RF system. Back in a little bit. Okay, folks, we are back, and we've changed over the server so that it now reads RF inside of all of the interfaces for mechanisms. So now we can see in RF what the values are going to be for everything. And we are storing 463 million RF in our laser amplifier. As soon as I flip that, it's going to shoot all of that power into the reactor, and hopefully this time we're going to get a reaction. Basically, I believe that it takes a minimum of 400 million RF, which is basically just a little bit above the second white line in the laser amplifier interface for what it stores. I think we're good. Actually, let me turn my chunk lines off. Don't need those right this minute. Bishop's over here for the our lighting of the reactor ceremony. So we're going to give this a go. Are we ready?
I'm ready.
Wait, make sure that we got the thing in it upstairs. I'm pretty sure it is.
It's in there.
Okay. Here we go.
There's the reaction.
Woof! We've got a reactor running. All right, let's go check out how much power we're producing. Are the ultimates filled up already? Are they filling? Yeah, are they filling? That's the question here. So, we will take a look here. We have tons of plasma. The reactor itself already has over, it's full, 400 million RF. It's full, and we've got tons of plasma. Our fuel is injecting at a rate of 2, is what it says, although it looks like it's just taking all the fuel that it will. We're just probably just pumping fuel into it.
And yes, the ultimates are all charged.
Now, right now, the plasma is going, the ultimates are completely charged. Nice.
Yes, completely charged.
So, yeah, in just a fraction of a second, we've completely charged 3 ultimate energy cells, plus another 400 million RF. So, at this point, I think we can go ahead and charge our laser amplifier back up, because we want to charge our laser amplifier back up at least enough to be able to ignite the reaction again, because we may not necessarily keep it running all the time.
Look, you're not even touching the batteries.
Probably not. Well, I'm not sure what we're producing, but I'm sure it's over the amount that those lasers are consuming.
Look how fast that amplifier is raising.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. And let's see, we are not even touching the amount of power that we are creating over here. We are dropping our plasma temperature down, but since our fuel is supposedly ejecting at a rate of 2, let's go check our fuel down here, make sure it's actually getting fuel. It should be getting fuel, no problem.
Yeah, it says fuel 0.
Yeah, it's going to probably say 0, because I think it's taking all of this plasma, or all of the DT fuel that it possibly can. So we may not be producing it quite fast enough down here, but I can fix that by speeding up our condensator that is turning the liquid back into gas. This one already has a full set of energy augments, but has no speed augments. So I might need to speed that up a little bit. This was just a temporary tank. We don't need that there now. We use that to fill up the, what is it called? What was the thing in the middle? Thing called? I forget.
The hologram.
A hologram. Yeah, hologram. That thing. That's what we use that tank for. So we can make osmium. We can give it a speed upgrade and see if that makes a difference.
Yeah, you're going to have to hurry because we're about to lose the reaction.
So we're not even close to losing the reaction. It has to go down below 100K before we lose the reaction temperature. I think.
Yeah, the case is at 171 and the plasma's at 250.
Well, plasma's already down to 250. Okay, we might need to go ahead and do that. So let's see if that is fast. There we go. Now we're producing 2 DT fuel per tick, I think is what that means. So we should be... The condensator...
We're still falling.
Well, it's going to fall until it reaches around 100K, because that's what we're set to. Our injection rate's only 2, which is the very minimal it takes to keep the reaction going. So it's going to fall until it gets down to a little bit... Yeah, until it gets around 100. It should stop just a little over 100. Plasma temperature 150. I could throw one more in there just to be 100% sure. It's not like we're not producing enough power.
We can actually up the rate too.
Yeah, well, let's not worry about that, because we're not using that much energy just yet. If we get to the point where we're using that much energy, we go up the rate. So let me up this a little bit more. Now, the problem with this is that we are going to run out of fuel eventually. Yeah,
okay,
there you go. We're burning.
Now we're heating back up.
Oh, it's heating up? Okay. So that rate of injection that you're seeing in there, that we're seeing in there, I think that only applies to if you actually have, if you actually are feeding it deuterium and tritium separately. Since we are injecting the combined field directly, we control that rate externally.
Yeah, now we're actually
heating up. Okay.
Yeah. Plasma's going back up.
I think we actually need to take that extra speed back out of the condensator so we're not using the fuel faster than we need to. And then we'll just have to kind of keep an eye on it. And if it gets close, or if it deactivates, I mean, we're already charging lasers back up, so we'll be able to reactivate it later, no problem. I'm pretty sure.
As long as the laser gets charged before the reaction stops.
Yeah. Well, I'm pretty happy with that. It's pretty awesome. It looks really awesome. Produces an insane amount of energy.
You better leave that speed upgrade in until this thing gets charged.
Well, I really want to see what it comes down to, because it's supposed to be rate of injection 2 is ideal for the minimal reaction. Is it going to slow down here in a minute? It'll probably slow down when it gets close to the temperature.
Yeah, this thing is changing colors down here.
Yeah, it does that. It basically just really cool graphic to look at in there. So yeah, there we go. I think that's pretty ideal. We've got the reactor going. And these lasers are kind of loud, but once they're charged up,
Did it level off?
Amplifier's charged up. I need to go back up and check it again. It was still dropping a bit when I was looking at it last. But the condensator was indicating that it was producing 2, that should be ideal. It's not leveled off yet.
I'll watch it.
As long as the plasma stays above 100K, the reaction will sustain. And the only other thing I wanted to do this episode, which I can probably go ahead and do real quick, is I wanted to make a chest from the RF tools, because I want to store all of our dimlets. You see over here, I moved everything up there, but we still have our dimlets down here in a double chest, and it's like almost completely full. So we need to get a better storage option for that, which should be fairly straightforward. We want to get storage scanner is pretty nice. It'll scan the chests in an area around it and tell you what you have in your inventories. What I actually want is the see if I can find it in here. Where is it at? Not the injector. There it is. Modular storage. So that's another nether quartz, a chest, and some redstone. Can I make this? I made one of those. I only want the one. Because you can only put one in a modular storage. Now, there is another storage option called a remote storage, and I think you can actually have more than one of the storage modules in it. So 2 is some gold nuggets, or gold ingots. And that should go. I'm probably not going to be able to shift-click this one. No, because this is not stackable. What was it? Gold there. Like that. And there we go. Tier 2. Now I probably need blocks of quartz for the final tier. Block of redstone. Is it iron? No, gold. 2 blocks of gold. So get us a tier 3. So chest, there we go, tier 3 module. And I have a place picked out for this. How's the reaction going? Is it did it stabilize?
Not yet. It's still dropping.
Is it dropping slower though?
Yeah, it's slowed down, but it's still dropping. So we're at 152 right now.
Okay, I think we're gonna be good. So there we go. Now I got a module in this. I could actually store some things in here. Well, the only thing I want in there is dimlets. And in fact, there is a specific module that will actually help me sort my dimlets. It's a dimlet storage module. So I need unknown, a piece of iron, some redstone, some paper. There's my paper. Piece of iron and redstone. I need the unknown dimlets. Do I have an extra one in here? Nope. All over here in this chest. Grab me an unknown dimlet. Jump over here, get two bits of redstone.
Well, this is actually charged up faster than we did earlier.
Is it? Good. Well, yeah, I mean, because we can continuously charge it now. There we go. Dimlet storage. So that's going to allow me to get a little bit of extra information, or basically it makes the sorting functions a little bit better for dimlets. So we'll put that in the middle one. And now all I need is the dimlets in there. Do you have cardboard boxes on you?
No, we don't have any. We lost them when we moved earlier.
Okay, well, I have two extras right here, actually. That'll work. Because I took the skeleton spawners out of them. What I had in them.
Well, this thing looks like it's about to slow down. It's going really slow now at 151.
151? Perfect. Because as long as it stays above 100, we're good. And if it's slowing down at 151, then it should be fine. Oh.
You'd have to look at it to make sure.
I think we're going to be good. So now I can take all these dimlets out of here. Especially the ones that aren't identified yet, and toss them in here, and I get a nice organized list of them that tells me what they are and their rarity level, which is the information at the end of the entry there. And I can use this to then sort for and look for specific modules. So I can sort them by name. There's different ways to sort them. You can sort them by count, sort on dimlet type, sort on dimlet rarity, and then name. And then I can also type in here, like, say I wanted forest. I don't have any forest. Okay, let's say I wanted a savanna. So there we go. I can pull up just my savanna ones. And this will store up to 300 item types. So I can have 300 different dimlets in there, different item dimlet types. And those can all be stacks, so I can actually have more than 300 items, but 300 item stacks. So we should be good for dimlet storage there now, I think. Shouldn't run out.
You put them all over here already?
I'm working on it. I only got a couple slots in my inventory open right now. You want to help?
Yep. I've already identified a stack of unknowns.
Oh, I see. Yeah, I'm not putting the unknown ones in there. I'll leave those in that chest for now because we're going to identify a bunch of them. Maybe keep just a couple. Grab those out and put them downstairs for some crafting because there's a few things I think there might still be one or two things I need to craft with unknown dimlets. So I'm going to hold on to
okay. them
down here.
So you took what you want to keep. All the rest of them needs to be identified?
All the rest of them can be identified, yes. All right. The only other thing that I changed since the last time since we came back is I did pulled up the machines that we had sitting in the middle of this floor and put them over there. These ones are going to be just for our ore processing. You can see that we've got an ender chest that we're going to be using to send ore back whenever we need to from the digital miner wherever we set it up. Probably going to be using a well, not the Elite. I'm going to upgrade that Elite into an Ultimate Energy Cube. Speaking of the Elite Energy Cube, I can go ahead and charge that up now that we've got plenty of power to do so. I was holding off because we were trying to charge the lasers Speaking of the lasers, how are they doing? They're about halfway up to a restart charge, if we need to. How is our fuel? Seems to be going down. So one of the things we do want to do eventually is get a daylight or a dimension that's daylight all the time. Because a major problem with our fuel supply is that it requires sunlight in order to create fuel. Is the sun about to go down, or is it just coming up? I can't tell. Just coming up. Okay, good. We're about to start producing fuel again. And the problem is like every time night comes around, these things completely cool off. We have to wait till they heat up again, and it's just not making our fuel as fast as we would like. I think
finally leveled off a little bit, I think.
Is it?
No, it's dropping, but it's really slow.
Okay, that's fine.
We're creating 199,500 RF a tick.
Okay, yeah. And, it's crazy. Crazy amount of RF a tick. It's awesome. So no energy problems in this base, for sure. All right, well, you got that taken care of. I think that now that this is all done, I think we're going to wrap this up. I hope you guys enjoyed this video as much as we enjoyed making it. If you did, be sure and leave a like, comment, and thumbs up. And until next time, I will catch you later.
Goodbye.